Thank you for auditing Professor Skye's record review, the only First Listen new music review show, which is hosted by a French professor. It used to be after I went to the gym, but there is no gym anymore. So, you know, I'm in the middle of this quarantine. I'm doing my best to stay sane and going on lots of walks and listening to music a lot more deeply than I usually do. I'm sort of allowing it to become the soundtrack of my life and really listen to whatever I'm reviewing three or four times as opposed to the usual one. And it's funny because I was discussing with, you know, with my kids all about this time and this sort of theory I have that this is their September 11th, right? I think that's a pretty reasonable thing to say. And my son asked me, hey, Dad, what was your soundtrack to 9/11? And my answer was very quick. The Blueprint by Jay-Z. I say that because the morning of 9/11, I went to the Watertown Mall. I went to, it must have been Strawberries, one of those kinds of lame record stores that used to exist. And I bought the Blueprint the second it came out. And that's what I used to do with everything Jay-Z released. And so it's funny because I remember very specifically in the weeks after 9/11, and I'm listening to the album and this sort of all this fear and all this emotion, it's all kind of tied in all together. And I remember even looking at the liner notes and going, who produced this IZZO song? Kanye West. Is that like a rap name? What kind of, is Kanye like a name? I don't know. Actually, I probably said Kanye. I don't know. So it's funny, you know, thinking about, you know, Kanye West and Jay-Z and this connection to this tragic national event. Of course, it's also weird, Kanye being the same age as me, Tom Brady being the same age as me, Tom Brady getting traded. There's nothing there. It's all coincidence. But it's all connected in my mind to my life. And so is there a chance that one of these albums that I review is going to be the soundtrack of COVID-19? Well, I think actually all of it will be a soundtrack to COVID-19. And this album is a perfect, perfect way of echoing what happened in 2001. You see, this album I'm going to be reviewing is called it's by someone named Jay Electronica. It's called A Written Testimony. And it's basically a Jay-Z album. I mean, Jay-Z produces it. I mean, he doesn't produce the music, but he's, you know, it's put on Rockefeller Records, you know, the record company that Jay-Z owns. And I would say Jay-Z is credited, you know, featuring Jay-Z nowhere on the entire album. But he's on almost every song. And the Jay-Z that we get here is one of the best Jay-Zs we've had in a long time. You see, like I said, I buy everything Jay-Z comes out with instantly because he's one of the best, if not the best rappers of all time. But in the last, I don't know, decade, the weight of being Jay-Z has made his albums and his releases a little bit ponderous, a little bit like he's suffering under how important he is, the fact that he's a mogul, the fact that he's a businessman, the fact that he's all these things, an icon, a king, a legend, a god, all that. This album brings me back to 2001. This actually brings me back to when Jay-Z was a little bit breezier. It's a word he used to use a lot. A little bit less obsessed with his own status as being a king and more just being a rapper. He feels easy. He feels happy. This is a happy sounding Jay-Z, not oppressed by his wealth or his status or the rejection of the moneyed elite in New York City. And that's just talking about Jay-Z. I haven't even gotten to this Jay Electronica guy. Now, apparently Jay Electronica has been making beats for as long as Kanye has. You know, he's been around for 20 years. I'd never heard of him. I don't pay that much attention. Sorry, my shirt is bugging me. I'm gonna take out my headphones. He's been around for a long time and he's never released an album. And so he releases this album and really it's just like a bomb. It's just like, it drops and you're just like, what the hell is this? This is amazing. You know, I listened to it with my son. He's like, what is this? I gotta download this. What is this music? This is not hip hop. Like, this is not modern hip hop. This is so damn good. This album is amazing. It's absolutely astounding. The primary soundscape is like, almost like jazz and vibraphones and like wood blocks. And it's got this really laid back, usually mournful tone. So I'm gonna go through it track by track. I'm going to address the central controversy that severely mars my appreciation of this album and makes it that I sort of hate this album as much as I appreciate it. We'll get there in a second. But it's definitely worth listening to. You know, I told you to go out and listen to Peter, Bjorn, and John. This is another one you absolutely have to listen to. You're stuck inside. You're doing nothing. Put on your headphones. If you have a fire, start a fire. If you have a window, look out a window. And just listen to this album. I would say, before I address the controversy, which makes it an album that I might never listen to again, that's not true, that's a bit far, but I would say, in a way, this is the closest thing that hip-hop has made to Pimp a Butterfly since Kendrick Lamar released that album. Not in terms of lyrical quality, it's not there. Not even in terms of production, it's not there either. But it has this sort of heavily instrumental, sort of non-hip-hop feel, like just sort of avoiding so many of the traps and having a totally unique sound and a very unified race, class, religion, conscious album that you just don't see in hip-hop. It manages to be like street and smart at the same time. And that's really hard to do. Rap artists really struggle with that a lot. And this album does that very well. Now listen, I didn't want to get into the controversy right off the bat. That's why I've given you 5 minutes of introduction. But the first song announces the controversy that is to come. The first song is called The Overwhelming Event, and it contains a large sample from Farrakhan, Louis Farrakhan, leader of the Nation of Islam. If you're like me, and you grew up in the late 80s and early 1990s, Louis Farrakhan was an insanely important figure in America, thanks to movies like Malcolm X, which actually didn't depict him very well, but still. But the concept of Malcolm X and the work of, and I'm going to go kind of Nardwuar here. I'm going to get more Nardwuar in a second. And especially albums like Fear of a Black Planet by Public Enemy. In this album, and in all of their music, they are so clearly aligned with the Nation of Islam that this idea that there's this group of African-American artists... I think I might have to pause it because someone's ringing at the doorbell. Who's ringing at the doorbell, man? We're not going to answer the door. What are you delivering? Coronas? Jeez. It's Samantha. All right. Turns out I did need to get that. But the thing about, you know, Public Enemy and the Nation of Islam is that it was part of this more racially conscious side of hip-hop, which ultimately was replaced and dominated by the more capitalist-driven gangster rap, right? So it was really hard, and it still remains really hard, when looking at that sort of early time in hip-hop in the 90s, in the early 90s and late 80s, to divide any kind of racially conscious hip-hop and the Nation of Islam. They were completely intertwined. So when I was younger, I didn't see any problem with it. I grew up in a fairly nice suburb of Boston, and I didn't think about Judaism. I didn't think about Israel. I didn't think about any of those things. None of it meant anything to me. So when I sort of heard these whispers about, oh, did you know the Public Enemy is saying racist, anti-Semitic stuff, it just didn't mean anything to me. If I'd actually paid attention and really studied what it meant, I don't know. Welcome to the Terror Dome might be the best song ever made. Like, not only might it be the best hip-hop song ever made, it might just be the greatest song ever created. It is a masterpiece. But when I, you know, went to college and started to learn and understand the plight of the Jewish people, it sucked. Because I all of a sudden realized, there is some very serious anti-Semitic messaging in there. And then I learned later that there's a lot more of it. And ultimately, what ended up happening was, like, it just got muddled. It felt unfair, you know? It felt like, why can't there be racially conscious rap that isn't also either subtly or overtly anti-Semitic? So this album by J. Electronica addresses this. It is a very, very strongly pro-Nation of Islam album with several questionable references to either Israel as Satan, which, you know, you can disagree with Israel's policy. Maybe not call him Satan, you know. You can call them an unjust state if you want. Not call them Satan. A couple other references here or there, and even quoting Farrakhan, who's very famous for saying very many anti-Semitic things, it makes it, it just sort of puts this damper on everything. So I said I was going to get a little bit more Nardwuar on you. And of course, I am a professor, you know? And so in a way, what this reminds me of is the most famous professor, you know, someone with the name professor in their name in music. That's, of course, Professor Longhair. That's a joke. Not a funny one. Professor Griff, so who is a member of the S1Ws. I try not to get him confused up with the SW1s. Who was very famous for being overtly like the most militant and the most anti-Semitic. So I don't know. This is actually a pretty good album, but I stopped listening to it. And the question is, will J. Electronica's record suffer the same fate? Oh, will it suffer the same fate? I don't think so. This is much better than Professor Griff's Chaos to Wisdom, and the entire album deserves a deep dive and explanation of what makes it so great. But why do I have to accept anti-Semitism to like good, racially conscious hip-hop? It is so frustrating to me. I mean, beyond the fact that after African Americans, I would say the racial ethnic group that has contributed most to hip-hop in America are Jewish Americans. What, you think WASPs did as much? Not even close. Not even close. So beyond the fact that it's a shame, right? I mean, beyond the fact that it's like horrible to have this sort of oppressed crime going on, I'm trying to take the good with the bad. And the good is that if you're talking about Nation of Islam, you are talking about things that aren't just about cars and money. You aren't just talking about bitches, and you aren't just talking about gats, and you aren't just talking about all this other stuff. You're talking about real issues that really matter. So we have to accept it. There is poison with this pill, but the pill is important to take all the same. So it starts off with the greatness, the sort of Nation of Islam track, the overwhelming event. And then it leads into the Ghost of Soulja Slim. And this is where it really, just really the first track. It's just astounding. You hear it, there's kind of this soft, jazzy beat, almost like a samba, and it starts with Jay-Z. And when I listen to it, I'm like, wait, is this... What's the deal with Jay-Z and names, by the way? His name is Sean, and his name is Jay. Okay, so why is that? Well, it's probably because he was a sidekick to a guy named Jazz O. So he was trying to make his name work, Jazz O, Jay-Z. But then if you are in New York and you go to Brooklyn, where he's from, there's a Jay-Z train. So you go, is that why it's Jay-Z? And he's like, no. And then he works with this guy, J. Electronica, to the point where I had to look up like 5 times on Google, is Jay-Z J. Electronica? Are they the same person? They're not, obviously. But what's going on here? Anyways, just a great track. There's even some like, sort of Griselda style ad-libs going on in the back that's quite good. Leading into the song Blinding, and this has a featuring with Travis Scott where I think he came in and just said Blinding and went home and just took the money because everyone's going to listen to this track, but it's an amazing track. Not self-produced. Most of this album is self-produced, not all of it. This is partly by Swizz Beatz, and you can hear the kind of griminess. There's a cool sort of ethnic music sample in the background. It's just an insane track. Just insane. Super awesome. And this is where some of his lyrical strengths come in. Not only, you know, I don't want to make it seem like the whole thing is some anti-Semitic rant. It's not. It's just one or two lines here or there. He's very reflective, and he's talking about looking in the mirror and seeing flaws in himself. It actually reminds me a little bit of a Jay-Z line off of a different one where he says, I could walk down the mirrors of Versailles and look myself in the eye and be so satisfied. This is kind of the opposite. He's looking at himself in the mirror and he's seeing flaws. It's a pretty consistent theme in this album. It's about racial equality, it's about mourning, and it's about self-doubt and how to overcome that self-doubt, mostly through music. Then the track Never-Ending Story is just great. It includes a sort of gatekeeping Prince reference. He talks about how he likes some obscure Prince song, not Raspberry Beret, kind of funny. He has these weird lines that are, I think, intentionally goofy and sort of stupid. Stupid's too strong. But he says, like, I think the line is, what is it? I'm trying to find here. I bring the love like Kermit the Frog. That's fine. Kermit the Frog brings love. But that's a really goofy lyric. He references Serge Gainsbourg, which is a great French singer. Someday I'm going to do a series of videos on this channel about Serge Gainsbourg, because I would say that he's like Dylan, but he's probably more interesting than Dylan. But kind of undercuts a lot of the anti-Semitism here, where he's calling out a great Jewish French singer, songwriter, I don't know. Jay-Z comes in and he's just awesome. He's just awesome. He's talking about, like, you know, the blue-eyed Jesus, and his rhymes, again, he has a sort of youth to him. For someone who constantly screams young, he often sounds old, but not in this case. Then the track Shiny Suit Theory. Now, if you're not familiar with the great rap battles of the late 90s and early 2000s, shiny suits was a very important term that applied to rappers like Mace and like Puff Daddy, that sort of made fun of them for having videos, usually directed by Hype Williams, dressed in suits that were shiny and dancing around with, like, you know, fisheye lenses, you know. And that was sort of seen as the pop garbage rap that was made by Puff Daddy and mostly the Bad Boy crew. And that was in opposition to the sort of the gangster rap and the sort of grittier stuff from New York, like the Wu-Tang Clan, but also like Jay-Z, which we'll get into in a second. So this is a great self-produced track. There's tons of vibraphone. Do, 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 do. It's really good. Like, one of the sort of trademarks of this album is the sound of kids cheering in the background, which... it's funny because so much of this album is mournful and sad and angry, and then having kids yelling, it's a nice juxtaposition. And then there's The Dream sings a little bit. And it's nice because the way The Dream sings, it sounds like a 70s sample, but it's not. It's just The Dream singing. And throughout this song, and I'm gonna play you a little bit of it. I should play you a little bit of it right now. There's a direct reference to the fact that Puff Daddy says to J Electronica that he should release an album, that he should stop being underground and start winning Grammys. And I think he should win a Grammy. I don't think there's going to be something better made this year. I don't think so. This is a really good album. Well, the anti-Semitism's not going to help. But it's like... he makes reference to... here, I'll play you the song. So this will give you a sense of what it sounds like. Listen to the vibraphones in the back, the kind of atmosphere. This self-produced doesn't sound like anything else that's being made out there. Shiny Suit Theory by J Electronica. Me and Puff, we was chilling in Miami. Said, nigga, fuck the underground. You need to win a Grammy for your mama and your family. They need to see you shine up. You built a mighty high ladder. Let me see you climb up. Nigga, what you scared of? Terrorize these artificial rap niggas and spread love. So, just a great, that doesn't do it justice. Actually, this album, you listen to it the first time and you like it. You listen to it a second time and you love it. It's that kind of album. Like, you get into it. You get into this atmosphere that it creates, this really singular atmosphere. But so he references Puffy. And it's funny because the last album that I reviewed, well, the second last album, was by Chica. And Chica is this, like, 22-year-old Instagram star who made a rap album. And a rap-ish album. There's some, I guess it's a rap album. It's kind of a mixture of a bunch of stuff. But in that, she makes direct reference to having Puff Daddy introducing her to Jay-Z. And it's funny, because if we go back to the idea of the shiny suit theory, like, Jay-Z and Puff Daddy, when I was in college, in the late 90s, you know, they were completely opposites. You know, I mean, they both were on the radio, but, like, one of them was hardcore and real, and the other was a shiny suit clown rapping over over Kashmir. But now, with time, they're almost always put together, and I think it's capital, it's money that's made them aligned, that they're now both moguls. So even though artistically one is a giant and the other is an ant, really, I mean, Puff Daddy has very little talent. Except for his talent as a mogul, which then makes him talented in finding good musicians, right? But still, they're somehow equated. And it's just funny that two albums in 1 week draw them together, make them on the same plane. When I was growing up, you would see them as being the absolute opposite. So, And it's one of the main themes of the record, which is, why is he releasing this album? He needs to be brave enough to show that he can do it. J. Electronica needs to get out of the shadows and drop an album. And he did. Like I said, it's a bomb. Oh, crap. I didn't mean that as a segue. But the next track starts off with a newsreel sample talking about the bombing of Nagasaki. So, this album drops like a Nagasaki bomb on you. And the next song is about the Nagasaki. Okay. The next track is called Universal Soldier, and just great. More kids screaming. And this is where it gets a little bit more mournful, a lot more socially conscious, racially conscious. Jay-Z's rapping a lot about like what's fair and what's not fair in our society and how should he be considered as a mogul. The next track is another... What is going on with my dogs? Can you put in the links if the dogs bother you? Because I can't tell. I think they're bothering me. Can't catch a break today. But the nice thing about the next track, Flux Capacitor. First of all, it's worth mentioning that I was talking about Chica and this person. Chica was born, like, in 1998, right? This guy, turns out, was born in 1976. He's older than me. So, like, both these albums are, like, about, like, the need to make music, you know? Like, the need to, like, come out and express yourself. And one of them's like, I'm finally releasing an album after almost a year of being on Instagram. The other's been behind the scenes making stuff for longer than that other person has been alive. Listen, I don't write this stuff. I don't create it. I just try to draw the links for you. So listen to Chica, an entire album about finally releasing an album when you're younger than this album, Written Testimony, by an artist who has not released an album for longer than that first person has been alive. Art is amazing, isn't it? Isn't it cool to have the same theme in both albums? It's awesome. It's even better than my dogs. I love my dogs, even though they keep barking. So Flux Capacitor, another one of the self-produced tracks. It's funny, this one I will always associate. I went to my local supermarket, to Wegmans. My dad didn't have enough food, so I had to shop for him. I had like a little squirt bottle of hand sanitizer in my jacket pocket. Every time I touched anything, I'd squirt it. My hands are just destroyed. But like, I remember listening to this song very specifically and listening to Jay-Z's verse while getting him cream chip beef by Stouffer's. So I think when I talk about music being the soundtrack of COVID-19, cream chip beef and Flux Capacitor. The reason I went on to the age thing is this is a very dated reference to Back to the Future, you know? And I don't think this guy cares. This guy makes a lot of old references. J. Electronica makes a lot of old references. And I really don't think he cares. I think he's just having fun making music. He's not trying to... That's the thing. Both he and Jay-Z are not trying to stay relevant and cool. Like, the only concession they make to trying to be young and cool is having Travis Scott go bling-ding for 1 second. But that's fine. But he can do that. On that one song that's kind of in the hip modular style, the one song with a hit hot rapper who shows up. And then the rest of it just has, oh, I don't know, Jay-Z on it the whole time. So Jay-Z's verse is amazing because he's talking about like, don't tweet about me if I die. Don't fake love. If you love me, go talk to my mother. All these kinds of like really deep things. And towards the second half of the album, the themes of death just come everywhere. Just constantly, constantly. This is a song where Jay-Z lets himself brag a little bit. Like, he talks like, I should have a watch like a Saudi prince. Not a bad line. But he also says boys and goyles. And I think that's a reference to Jay Pharoah's impersonation of Jay-Z. So I think he's showing that he has a sense of humor about himself, which I don't always think that Jay-Z has a sense of humor about himself. But like I said, he's very breezy on this album. And that's evidence of it. The next track, Fruits of the Spirit, is funny. It has a little bit of Spanish in the beginning, which is, I ended up having a dream last night because I was listening to this album before going to bed. I had a dream where I was screaming at my students in Spanish, and I'm a French professor, so that's pretty funny. This is just like a very simple ditty, like just a simple beat. I think it's by The Alchemist, good producer. It doesn't develop at all. Just just one song, but he raps and lyrics are so good. Racism. He even makes reference to he uses the word azimuth. This guy really knows his stuff. Like, he makes interesting, often goofy, but really well done lyrics. I think this is the one too, where he actually makes reference to one of these. He makes a pretty interesting Star Wars reference, where he says, "I was born in Tatooine." Oh, I'm in my Chewbacca museum, by the way. That's where I'm filming. Did you know I have a Chewbacca museum? I do. He says, "You know, I was born in Tatooine, but I live in Dagobah," and there's like a little lightsaber sound effect in the back. So he's also a little nerdy, which I think doesn't hurt when rappers allow themselves to admit that they are nerdy as well. He's never trying to be hard, actually, on this whole album. He's very vulnerable. He's very open to his own weaknesses, to his own emotional state. More dogs. I hate editing, but what are you going to do? What else am I going to do today? So what I was getting at was the song Shiny Suit Theory, I already discussed, actually makes direct reference to being in therapy, and both Jay-Z and Jay Electronica talk about being in therapy and their psychological profiles. And this is really important. You know, I think that if we have sort of pop rap talking about depression in sort of a real, you know, superficial way, you know, like, I'm going to kill myself because of that girl and maybe because of all of the opiates I'm taking. Like, if we have that, issues of mental health, and we have sort of more established rappers rapping about mental health, that might help some of the issues. Because mental health across the board in America needs to be more addressed. And I would say that the population that is represented, that consumes hip-hop music, might be in more need of direct instruction to seek mental health. And that's kind of what they're saying here. the track Ezekiel's Wheel is just unbelievable. I mean, there's just like... You know, this is the song that talks about Star Wars. Really engaging, laid-back, rhythmic style. At one point, Jay Electronica even just sort of, like, stops rhyming. He's just like, dip-a-dip, dip-a-dip, dip-dip. There's, like, this weird, super-long, full-throated defense of Michael Jackson, which I'm not a big fan of. But it just, it's all pulled off just right. And it's more of the sort of downbeat side of this album. The album kind of goes in between sort of a little bit of bravado, like, hey, I'm making an album, and then a lot of stuff about mourning. And that's what leads to APIDTA, which I looked up. Turns out stands for All Praise is Due to Allah. You're hearing a lot of Allah on this album, which makes sense. Made by a Muslim, and... you're supposed to say the name Allah a certain number of times throughout the day. I don't know how many it is. It's not 10,000. That's way too many. That was the number that jumped ahead. If you know the answer, put it in the comments. So this is just an insanely beautiful song about death. There's not a lot of great songs about death. Speaking of Dylan, Death is Not the End. In particular, the cover by Nick Cave. Just a great song. When the Man Comes Around by Johnny Cash, that's a great song about death. Not a lot of great songs about death that I can think of, especially in hip-hop. And this song, very clearly, again, this guy is about my age, very clearly his mom just died. My mom died 3 years ago, but it feels like it was yesterday. And it's this song where he talks about, I have numbers on my phone that will never ring again. I've got texts on my phone that'll never bing again, something like that. And it's like talking about the way that our phones exist as permanent reminders. You know, we have all these technological reminders of people. And like, you know, I'm never going to talk to my mom on the phone again. That's what he's saying. But he's saying it through this interesting way. I actually just changed the voicemail message at my parents' house. It used to say, you've reached Michael and Victoria's house. And it's been that way for 3 years. And every time I'd call my dad, I'd start crying. So... you know, it's a very human thing. This goes way beyond religion and race and class. It's just a song, beautiful, creepy reverb guitar in the background. Just a song about death. It really is. It's just astounding. There's this one line where he talks about lumps in his throat the size of, like, a tower Eiffel. And then he says, I wonder, sometimes I wonder, do trees get sad when they see leaves fell. And this is a great example of something that he does a fair amount, and something that I think is, I don't know if there's been an academic paper done on intentional misusage of grammar in hip hop for either shocking or rhythmic or rhyming purposes, but it's a very well-used tool by J. Electronica. Because this guy's talking about azimuth, right? So it's clearly he's educated and he knows how to pronounce things and he's an old guy. He's not some 22-year-old kid who, you know, dropped out of high school or anything. He's very clearly he knows how to speak the Queen's English, so to speak. So when he says this line, "Sometimes I wonder, do trees get sad when they see leaves fell?" It's just poetry. It's just beautiful, the same way that, you know, Cummings or whatever would play with the language, or Langston Hughes for that matter, a sort of a willful manipulation of language to draw your attention to it. And you hear it, and I played it for my daughter while I was making breakfast this morning, parfait. And she was like, "Shouldn't it be leaves fall?" I'm like, "It should be. Why do you say leaves fell?" I'm like, "Well, one, it rhymes. And then the other is it's kind of shocking and it draws your attention in." And it reminds me of the Lil Uzi Vert album. And when I review the Lil Uzi Vert album, he does this as well. And I think, and I don't know, correct me in the comments, I guess I am a hip hop scholar, but I don't consider myself to be a world expert. I believe Lil Wayne is the person who really popularized this style. You know, saying things like, when I have them instead of when I have them, right? Like intentionally messing things up. And he does it in such a great way. And one of my criticisms of the Lil Uzi Vert album is he's not very good at this. He tries doing it, but it doesn't have the strength. It doesn't have that shock and surprise. Maybe because you don't trust that he has a mastery of the English language the way clearly Lil Wayne does and the way J. Electronica does. God damn. I'm having fun talking about this stuff. I hope you enjoy this video. I really do. But I am enjoying thinking about this album so much. It's just great. It's really great. It's really great to think about. So yeah, so he's using that style, but it's not as clumsy or as lazy as Lil Uzi Vert. And that's the end of the album. You know, I should probably also mention on the track Ezekiel's Wheel, he makes direct reference to Black Steel and the Hour of Chaos, which is a Public Enemy song, not on this album, on a different one. And there you go. Like I said, it may be the closest thing to Pimp a Butterfly that we've seen, particularly in the instrumentation, the way that it feels more jazzy than hip-hoppy, and just these constant themes. It's always making you think about race and class and equality and inequality and rage. You can't erase the unfortunate aspects of it. But the greatness of it also is part of that unfortunate aspect. So, I don't know. Do with that what you will. Hey, did you listen to this album? What do you think? Am I totally off? If you're a member of the Nation of Islam, could you correct me? Because if I'm wrong on something, because it's really interesting. It's weird because in popular culture, we were thinking about it all the time, and then now we think about it none of the time. I think it was because September 11th, going back to that, made it pretty unhip. But I don't know. I remember going to Oakland and seeing a Red Sox game in Oakland, and you used to be able to get bean pies from the Nation of Islam sold to you at the stadium. That was awesome. So much better than a hot dog. All right. Well, anyways, for Public Enemy, for Professor Longhair, Professor Griff, this is Professor Skye. I can't wait. Tomorrow's new music. Morrissey's coming out with a new album. Uh-oh. Ooh. I'm so scared. So I'll hopefully be reviewing that soon. There's the camera.